قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب المجيد بعده أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا صدق الله العلي العظيم أما بعد. My dear respectful brothers and elders of Islam and Iman, I greet you with a greeting of Salamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuhu. And I greet you with this greeting because this is the greeting of the people of Jannah. And this is that greeting which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he taught his sahaba and his companions this honorable and this beautiful greeting. Today's khutbah, I will be speaking about a personality in Islam who many of the ulama have said that she is the most beloved thing in creation to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. I'm going to be speaking about a lady called Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha warda. A lady who we all love and we honor, yet we know very little about her. Whenever we mention her name radiallahu anha, we immediately become soft and immediately tears fall and begin to fall down our cheeks when we remember such a great personality, such a great woman has this woman. However, before I get in the gist of speaking to you about this great woman, I quoted to you a verse in Al-Quran Al-Kareem at the beginning of today's khutbah. It is in Surah Al-Ahzab, which is chapter 33 of the Quran. Chapter 33 of the Quran, verse 33. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala re-emphasizes to us and re-emphasizes the greatness of Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And I read to you, and I'll read it again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُظْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ رِجْسَ أَهْلِ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَاهِرَاكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. The full ayah goes, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O family of the house, O family of the house, Allah only wishes to distance fault from you. Allah will only wish to remove all defect in you, all negativity that a man has, a woman has, all the forms of negativity, or what we call things which are not positive, things which are, for example, not right. Allah said that we want to purify you, we want to keep you protected, we want to remove all of these negativities from you. In other words, we want to distance all fault from you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and we want to cleanse you. We want to cleanse you. And we want to purify you abundantly. This ayah says. The ayah says what? That Allah is referring to the house, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you look at the Arabic, which I have in front of me, Allah used the word rijis. Rajasa comes from the Arabic root word. This generally means impurity. However, according to all of the ulama, it is an agreement upon every Muslim scholar that when Allah blessed Ahlul Bayt in this ayah, the meaning of the word rijis here means that we protect you from kufr and shirk. Not that you were impure. Because if you believe that physically the Ahlul Bayt were impure, you are a non-Muslim. If you believe that the Ahlul Bayt in its originality were impure, you fall and you become a non-Muslim. Why? Who is the first Ahlul Bayt? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He cannot be impure. He is only pure. So Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi and many, even Imam at-Tabri, on their understanding of this ayah, they said what? They said when Allah said that we want to purify the family of the Prophet ﷺ, he meant what? He said we want to remove kufr from you. We want to protect you from shirk, from bid'ah, from the wrong innovations, the innovations which are wrong, those that go against the Sharia. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, in his Musnad, when he quoted this hadith, he gives six chains or six individual or independent chains of transmission to this hadith. And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal said that this hadith was authentic. Imam At-Tirmidhi, when he narrated this hadith in his collection of hadith, Imam At-Tirmidhi said, and he collected 7 chains. And he came to the conclusion and said the hadith was sahih. He says, Hassan was sahih. And Imam At-Tabrani and many other ulama have narrated this hadith. That Salama said that when this ayah was revealed, the Prophet said, where is Fatima? He called Fatima. He called Ali, Karamallahu Wajhul Kareem. And he called Al-Hassan wal-Hussein. He brought them together and he did the mubalaha. He covered them in his cloth. And Sayyidina Ali was behind him, according to one narration. According to others, the narration is that on his right was Al-Hassan, on his left was Al-Hussein, in front of him was Fatima to Zahra, and behind him was Sayyidina Ali. There is differences on this. All of them are there. The Prophet covers them in this blanket. Imagine being covered by this blanket now. The beauty of receiving that nur. The Prophet covers them and he says, Allahumma haula yahlil bayt. The Prophet ﷺ says, Allahumma haula ahlil bayti. The Prophet ﷺ re-emphasizes the ayah. And he says what? He says, oh Allah, these are my family. These are my ahlul bayt. These are my offspring. Oh Allah, protect them. Oh Allah, remove shirk from them. Protect them from fasad. Protect them from corruption. And Allah, purify them. Purify them. There is another very beautiful hadith which we find narrated by Qadi Ayyad. Qadi Ayyad, the author of Ash-Shifa. Ash-Shifa Sharif, a very famous book in the Arabic language, which I'm sure is available in English. And this is a book that describes the physical characteristics of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he walked and did such a thing. And the hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the following. He says, "Man ahabbani wa ahabba hadaini." He said, "Whoever loves me and loved these two." And then he said, "Wa ashara ila Hussein wal Hassan." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Whoever loves me and whoever loves these two people, these two youngsters," he was pointing towards Al-Hussein and Al-Hassan. And then he says, "Wa abahuma," and their father. "Wa ummahuma," and their mother. What did he say? "Whoever loves me and loves these two people, Al-Hassan and Hussein, and loves their father Ali, Karamallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, and loves their mother, Al-Fatima to Zahra, radiyallahu anha warda," what did the Prophet ﷺ say? He says, "Kana ma'i. Kana ma'i fi darajat yawm al-qiyamah." Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam. The Prophet said that if you love these 5 individuals on the day of judgment, you will be with me. Yet the Prophet said, irrespective of how many amal you do, irrespective of how much zakat you give, irrespective of all of this, as long as you love my Ahlul Bayt and you love Ali wal Hussein, he said, wallahi, you will be with me. You will be with me at my darajat in Yawm al-Qiyamah. How beautiful this hadith is. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, referring to his beautiful daughter, Al-Fatimah Zahra, radiyallahu anha warda. Yani, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam said in the authentic hadith regarding his beloved daughter, Fatima Zahra, salamallahu alayha. He said regarding her, which is narrated by Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih. He said what? "Innaha bad'atun minni yugdibuni man aghdabaha." He said what? He says, Fatima radiyallahu anha warda, she is part of me. Fatima is a physical juz, is a part from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She is from me. Physically, her blood is my blood. Her flesh is my flesh. Could you imagine the flesh, the beauty of Fatima to Zahra radiallahu anhu radha? The Prophet said that whoever loves Fatima, he said, Fatima is from me, and whoever angers her, angers me. Whoever angers Sayyidatu Fatima radiallahu anha will anger me. And she was born on Friday. Yawmul Jum'ah she was born on. The 20th of Jamadu Thani. Approximately 5 years before the Prophet announced his wahi. Before the Prophet announced his nabuwa. Before he announced to the people that he was a prophet. Al-Fatimatu Zahra radiallahu anha warda was born. She was his fifth child. She was his fifth child. And from all of his daughters, she was the youngest and most beloved to him. The hadith says that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam would go anywhere, he would take her with her. Her mother was called Khatija al-Kubra radiallahu anha warda. Al-Khatija, the honorable wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who we believe is the first Muslim, is the first believer in Islam, the first Muslima in Islam, even before Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda, before everyone, when there was no one there, Khatija al-Kubra became Muslim. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, when he turned towards Aisha radiallahu anhu warda, and this is narrated in Bukhari, he said to her, and Aisha said, why do you remember us so much? Why do you remember Al-Khatija al-Kubra so much, Ya Rasulullah? He said, wallahi, and I'm not quoting word by word, I'm giving a summary of what she said. He said, because that is the woman who supported me when there was no one there. She covered me, she comforted me, she sat with me, and she supported me when no one would support me. She was the mother of Fatimatu Zahra radiallahu anhu warda. And she, Fatimatu Zahra, she was brought up in the house of the Prophet sallam. Meaning when she came in the house, when she was born, all of her sisters had got married. All of her sisters had got married. Bibi Zainab radiallahu anha was married. Ruqayya was married. Kulsum was married. Because before Islam, these were married to Abu Jahl's, Abu Lahab's sons. And we know in the narrations. So she was by herself in the house. And she was brought up under the tender care of her mother and Ayman. Allahu Akbar. Ayman. Baraka we call her. The mother of Baraka. The mother of Baraka. And let me share one thing with you, because when I speak about Ayman, my heart becomes so soft. And wallahi, I cry so much when I remember the name of Ayman, because she is the woman. Radiallahu anha warda, when she migrated to Medina, she was walking barefooted. She had blisters on her feet. And when she arrived in Medina, she says, Aina Muhammad, Aina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where is the Prophet? The Sahaba said, you know, get some food, get some water. She's not interested. She's only interested in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet comes, the Prophet sees her and he cries. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He goes to her according to one narration. He takes some cloth and he begins to clean the blisters on her feet. Overcome by his love for this woman, because she was the Prophet's mother. She was the servant of his father, Abdullah. And when he got married to Amina radiallahu anha warda, she became the Prophet's mother in one way, servant. The Prophet said to all the Sahaba, like I'm speaking to you now. He said, today, I guarantee Jannah to anyone who marries this woman. I guarantee Jannah to anyone who will marry this woman, Ayman. All the Sahaba are looking. Let me give you one analogy. Ayman was black. She was extremely old. She had a round face, a round nose. She was from Abyssinia, like Bilal radiallahu anhu. She was Habashi. Who wants to get married to an old woman? Let me ask you. I said to you, get married. No one's going to get married to an old woman. From all of these people, Sayyidina Zaid bin Haritha put his hand up. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I will marry her. Zaid radiallahu anhu was barely 30 years old. Beautiful long hair, well built, beautiful white color. The ideal husband. And what was produced from that marriage? Osama bin Zaid. At the age of 17, he's leading an army of Islam. The last thing the Prophet said before he left this world was, don't delay the army of Osama. So Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha warda, she was brought under the care, and she was brought up under the care of Ayman radiallahu anha warda. And whenever the Prophet walked, she walked with him. Wherever he sat, she sat with him. Wherever he went out, she went with him. If he ate, she ate with him. If she drank, she drank with him. And even the Prophet ﷺ, whenever he went out, he always took her. To such an extent, many people become Islam and she witnessed it. And I want to share with you a very beautiful story. That when you look at this girl, she was merely 10 years old. She wasn't even 10 years old. About close, according to Bukhari, he said 10. According to the other narrations we have, they say approximately 10 years old she was. Radiallahu anha warda. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put her love into our heart. And with that love, may that love be a means for us to get to Jannah. Because if we love her, and we love her husband, and we love Al-Hassan wal-Hussein, we will be with the Prophet at his darajat in Yawm al-Qiyamah. So the Prophet he goes to the Kaaba with his daughter, and he goes to Al-Hijr, a place near the Kaaba at that time, and he began to pray. He went to the Hijr and he began to pray. And while he was praying, and Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha is next to him. The Quraysh see this. The leaders of Al-Quraysh, they see that Muhammad ﷺ is physically, publicly praying to his God. So Al-Quraysh, they come to him. A mob, a group of the leaders of Al-Quraysh, amongst them are Abu Jahl bin Hisham. Abu Jahl, who is Sayyidina Umar's uncle, maternal uncle. Abu Lahab is there. Amongst them is a man called Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt. Amongst them is Umayyah bin Khalaf. Amongst them is Shayba and Utba, the sons of Rabi'ah. They all gather around him. And Abu Lahab says, Afwan Abu Jahl says, who amongst you has the audacity? Who amongst you will be able to go and get the inner organs of a slaughtered animal? The intestines, the stomach, the disgusting parts of an animal. Who amongst you is willing to get those things and throw it on his head? A'udhu billah. Challenging. You know, who's going to do it? And from amongst them, this man called Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt, he did it. He went and he gathered the most disgusting, smelly intestines you could think of. And he gathered it together, and when the Prophet ﷺ went to sijda, he threw it on him. A'udhu billah. He threw it on him, onto his shoulders, onto his honorable head, sallallahu alayhi wa ala abdallah salatu wa salam. And when he did this, they began to laugh at him. Could you imagine? I, like you, I have a son. My son is 2 years old. My son is 6 years old. I have two, alhamdulillah. My eldest son is 6 years old. If he's sitting in front of me and you do that to me, what physical impact will that have on me as a father, let alone my child? They're laughing that this is your prophet. No one is willing to approach them. And this 10-year-old child, Al-Fatimah Zahra radiallahu anha, she turns to Al-Quraysh and she shouts at them. She says, how dare you throw this on my father? 10 years old. And she then begins to challenge Al-Quraysh. Wallahi, the narration says that not one of the Quraysh said anything to her. Not one of them rose and said, what have you done? They all kept quiet. Radiallahu anha. And she then went to her father, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she began to clean him. She began to remove these disgusting things. And she began to cry. A 10-year-old child. The Prophet looked at her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he cried. He cried immensely. He said, oh Allah, curse Al-Quraysh. This is the dua. He says, oh Allah, may the la'na of Allah be upon Quraysh. He said it 3 times. And then he said, oh Allah, curse Abu Lahab. Oh Allah, curse Fulan and Fulan. All of these people that did this on the battle of Badr, they died.
All of these people that did this on the Battle of Badr, they died, and they died a humiliation death. This 5-year-old child looking after the welfare of her father. And that is why it is said that some of the people called her Abiha, the mother of her father. Subhanallah. They called her what? The daughter, the mother of the father, because of the love and care she had for her father. She stood up to the Quraysh. And let me share one thing. When she did that, do you know who was there? Even Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu warda was there. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, these are big Sahaba. I am not belittling any of them radiallahu anhu warda. We do not speak ill of any of the Sahaba. No one spoke in front of the Quraysh apart from Fatima to Zahra. No one. No man, no woman, no teenager, no mature person. Only Az-Zahra radiallahu anha, she stood up and she challenged them. Subhanallah. And in the hadith of Sahih, which we find in Bukhari, the Prophet said, in the entire world, there are 4 women that are the greatest of all women. There are 4 women that are the greatest of all the women in the world. He said, number 1 is Asiya, Salamullah Alaiha, the wife of Fir'aun. The wife of Fir'aun who brought Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam up. He said, number 2 is Maryam, Salamullah Alaiha, the mother of Sayyidina Isa, or Jesus Christ, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said, number 3 is who? Al-Khadija Al-Kubra. His wife. Not any wife, his first wife. And then he said what? He said the 4th is his daughter, Fatimatu Zahra. The greatest of all the women. And that is why it is said, and I'm coming to the end part of my khutbah, and I will be very quick. It is said what? It is said that if you gather all the believing women, and when it said that they were the greatest, it wasn't referring to this ummah. It was referring from Adam until the Day of Judgment. And she was given the title as the leader of all the women in Jannah. All the women in Jannah, she is the leader of. Even her mother is underneath her. The leader of all the women in Jannah is Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha warda. And that is why Aisha radiallahu anha, our mother, the mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha warda says what? She narrates and says that wallahi, no one resembled the Prophet in his walking, in his sitting, in his speaking, in his manners, more than Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha warda. No one from all the Sahaba, Abu Bakr, Umar, Ali, Uthman, Talha, Zubair, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Sa'd ibn Waqas, bring all the Sahaba radiallahu wa ridwan Allahumma alayhim ajma'in. None of them resemble the Prophet more in the action than Fatima Zahra, his daughter. In everything that she did. And remember one thing, this is not a Sahabi telling you this. This is Aisha telling you this, the Prophet's wife. And what she saw, remember when the man came to him, when Sa'd bin Hisham came to her and said, what was his character like? She said, Khuluqul Quran. His character was the Quran. Because she knew him, and she knew him when the curtains closed. She knew him at home. She said, this is about Fatima Zahra. Allahu Akbar. And whenever she came to meet the Prophet, whenever she came anywhere, public, privately, the Prophet, when he saw her, he would stand for her. He would stand for his daughter. And he would greet her and say salam. He would kiss her. Then the narration says he would kiss her on the cheeks and he would hug her. Another narration, he would say, she's from me. This is my beloved. And then what he would do, he would stand and he would make her sit where he sat. And when the Prophet visited her, radiallahu anha, she would stand. And she would stand, and what did she do? She used to go to Prophet, she would kiss his hand. A narration said she would kiss the feet. Another narration said she would touch or kiss the forehead. And after doing all of this, she would then make the Prophet sit in her place. Time is really limited. Yet I haven't even touched the life of this great woman. I've only touched a few fadail, greatness of this woman. Let me share with you two things and I will finish. Sayyidati Fatima, from all of her sisters, she was the only one that was married to a poor person. All her sisters were married to rich people. Uthman was a rich man, Ali was not, radiallahu anhu warda. So anyway, when she got married, she moved, and the Sayyidina Ali's house was not next to the masjid, it was a bit further. And she, because of poverty, she used to work, and she used to do, you know, the corn. You know, the corn to make wheat. And her hands became blistered. And one day she went to Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhul kareem, and she said, "Oh my husband, I can't do this no more. Look at my hands, they become blistered." Sayyidina Ali said, "I become so tired physically. So why don't you do this? Go to your father. And I've heard that he is giving slaves away from booty, from a war. Why don't you ask for something?" She goes to the Prophet. And again the Prophet welcomed her. He stood up for her, everything honored her. He says, "What has brought you here, my beloved?" He knew really what she wanted. But he wanted to see her. Fatima the Zahra said, "Wallahi, oh my honorable father, I've only come to give salam to you." And she goes back home. When she goes back home, Sayyidina Ali said, "What happened?" She tells him, "What happened?" So Sayyidina Ali said, "We'll both go." The next day they both go to the Prophet ﷺ, and they told him what happened. The Prophet said, "You do not need it." He said, "The people of Ahl al-Sufa, the poor, need it more than you." You see the Prophet, how just he is, not because of his daughter. This is what you call justness. This is what you call accountability. Real transparency. He said, "What?" He said, "Not just because of my daughter." He said, you don't deserve this. You can't have it." And she went home and they were upset. At night time, he went to their house and he knocked on the door. He said, "Can I come in?" They said, "Yes." And both were lying down. And they were going to stand up. He said, "Lie, don't get up." And the Prophet sat next to him and said to them, "Shall I tell you something more better? And shall I give you something more better than what you asked me?" Ali radiallahu anhu wardan and his wife said, "Yes." He said, the Prophet said, after every salah, read 33 times, "Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar." You know what we read in our salah? This tasbih is from Fatima to Zahra radiallahu anha. You read this tasbih because of her. Radiallahu anha wa salamallahu alayha. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us and give us that ability. Let me finish off with one last thing. I think I've got about maybe 2-3 minutes and I will end this. But it's a beautiful thing which we should share. When the Prophet was ill, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he used to call Fatima to him regularly. And one day she came and Aisha radiallahu anha said, "I left them alone." The next day the Prophet called her again and he kissed her. And he said something into her ear and she began to cry immensely. She began to cry. Non-stop she began to cry. Cry and cry. And again the Prophet looked at his daughter. He can't take the pain of his daughter. The Prophet could not take it that his daughter is crying. And he said to her, "Come back here." When she came back to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he kissed her again and he said something else. And she became happy. Joyful. So happy. Aisha was troubled. Aisha radiallahu anha said, Ya, O Fatima, what did the Prophet say to you? You went to him once and you cried. She said, "The first time I went to him, he said to me, I'm leaving you. He said, my time has come to an end now. I have to return to my Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala." Subhanallah. And she radiallahu anha warda, she cries immensely, she cries. Tears are falling down her eyes. And she said, when he saw this, he called me again. And he said, "O Fatima, my daughter, my beloved, don't cry. Because I give you the glad tidings that from all of my family, you will be with me in Jannah. Very soon, you don't need this dunya. You will be with me." She became happy. And that is why approximately 6 months later, at the age of 29 years old, Aisha, Fatima Zahra, radiallahu anha arda, she passed away. And her son, Al-Imam Al-Hassan, was only 7 years old, and Imam Al-Hussein was 6 years old. And before she passed away, there is a narration which is weak, however it is acceptable. that when she